Okay. Yes. You ready?
No, no, I guess I could try to get myself.
Okay. So I have your copy of the... What do you need? Good morning.
Good morning, Tom.
And welcome to St. Elizabeth and Seaton Parish for the celebration of Palm Sunday, of the Passion of our Lord. Thank you for joining us. It's great to see you again. And a special welcome to all those joining us on the live stream this morning. Before you silence your phones today, please remember to share with your friends on social media where you're celebrating your faith today. You can better participate in the liturgy if you have a worship aid. You can download one at our website, www.seaseton.org. That's SEASETON.ORG. The three horizontal lines in the top left will reveal the resources link, and clicking on that will open today's worship aids link. Or you could use the QR code in the bulletin. Our prelude is a song called Love Unknown, and it's in the worship aid. So please join us. My song is Love Unknown. My Savior's love for me. Love to the loveless shown that they might lovely be. Oh, who am I that for my sake my Lord shall take frail flesh and sometimes they strew his way and his sweet praises sing, resounding all the day, hosannas to their King. Then crucified
I
They rise and needs will have. My days or take away. A murderer they saved, the Prince of Life they slay. Yet cheerful be to suffering go. That he his foes from thence might free. Skip that. Okay. Our presider this morning is Father Paul Sparklin, and he is assisted by our deacon, Mr. Jack McCabe. So we pray to please stand now and welcome each other to this celebration. Our entrance processional is number 498, 498, all glory, laud, and honor, 498. And please turn towards the back of the church where we commence the liturgies of Holy Week.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. Please hold up your palm branches. Almighty, ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King with exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem with him who lives and reigns forever and ever.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Jesus proceeded on his journey up to Jerusalem. As he drew near to Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples. He said, "Go into the village opposite you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tethered, on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. And if anyone should ask you, 'Why are you untying it?' you will answer, 'The master has need of it.' So those who had been sent went off and found everything just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owners said to them, 'Why are you untying this colt?' They answered, 'The master has need of it.' So they brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks over the colt, and helped Jesus to mount. As he rode along, the people were spreading their cloaks on the road. And now, as he was approaching the slope of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to praise God aloud with joy for all the mighty deeds they had seen. They proclaimed, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." He said in reply, "I tell you, if they keep silent, the stones will cry out." The Gospel of the Lord.
Dear sisters and brothers, like the crowds who acclaim Jesus in Jerusalem, let us go forth in peace.
All glory, Lord, and honor to you, Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children make sweet hope.
Let us pray. Reminder, please. Almighty, ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord has given me a well-trained tongue, that I may know how to speak to the weary, a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ear that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like a flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
God, my God, why have you abandoned me? My God, my God, why have you abandoned me? All who see me deride me. They curl their lips, they toss their heads. He trusted in the Lord, let him save him. Let him release him, for in him he delights. My God, my God, why have you abandoned me? Horns have surrounded me, a band of the wicked besets me. I can count every one of my bones. My God, my God, why have you abandoned me?
It's a reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. That is the name of Jesus. Every knee should bend, and those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory and praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Christ became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. Glory and praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Our tradition teaches us that we stand for the gospel. However, if you cannot stand for a long period of time, you may be seated. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. When the hour came, Jesus took his place at table with the apostles. He said to them,
I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I shall not eat it again until there is fulfillment in the kingdom of God.
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and said,
take this and share it among yourselves. For I tell you that from this time on, I shall not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes.
Then he took the bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, saying,
"This is my body, which will be given for you. Do this in memory of me."
And likewise the cup, after they had eaten, saying,
"This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which will be shed for you. And yet, behold, the hand of the one who is to betray me is with me on the table. For the Son of Man indeed goes as it has been determined, but woe to that man by whom he is betrayed."
And they began to debate among themselves who among them would do such a deed. Then an argument broke out among them about which of them should be regarded as the greatest. He said to them,
"The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are addressed as benefactors. But among you it shall not be so. Rather, let the greatest among you be as the youngest, and the leader as the servant. For who is greater, the one seated at table or the one who serves? Is it not the one seated at table? I am among you as the one who serves. It is you who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer a kingdom on you, just as my Father has conferred one on me, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded to sift all of you like wheat. But I have prayed that your own faith may not fail. And once you have turned back, you must strengthen your brothers."
He said to him,
"Lord, I am prepared to go to prison and to die with you."
But he replied,
"I tell you, Peter, before the cock crows this day, you will deny me three times that you know me."
He said to them,
"When I sent you forth without a money bag or a sack or sandals, were you in need of anything?"
"No, nothing."
They replied, he said to them,
"But now one who has a money bag should take it, and likewise a sack, and one who does not have a sword should sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you that this scripture must be fulfilled in me, namely, he was counted among the wicked. And indeed, what is written about me is coming to fulfillment."
Then they said,
"Lord, look, there are two swords here."
But he replied,
"It is enough."
Then, going out, he went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he arrived at the place, he said to them,
"Pray that you may not undergo the test."
After withdrawing about a stone's throw from them and kneeling, he prayed, saying,
"Father, if you are willing, take this cup away from me. Still, not my will, but yours be done."
And to strengthen him, an angel from heaven appeared to him. He was in such agony, and he prayed so fervently that his sweat became like drops of blood falling on the ground. When he rose from prayer and returned to his disciples, he found them sleeping from grief. He said to them,
"Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not undergo the test."
While he was still speaking, a crowd approached, and in front was one of the 12, a man named Judas. He went up to Jesus to kiss him. Jesus said to him,
"Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss?"
His disciples realized what was about to happen, and they asked,
"Lord, shall we strike with a sword?"
And one of them struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said in reply,
"Stop, no more of this."
Then he touched the servant's ear and healed him. And Jesus said to the chief priests and temple guards and elders who had come for him,
"Have you come out against a robber with swords and clubs? Day after day I was with you in the temple area, and you did not seize me. But this is your hour, the time for the power of darkness."
After arresting him, they led him away and took him into the house of the high priest. Peter was following at a distance. They lit a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat around it, and Peter sat down with them. When a maid saw him seated in the light, she looked intently at him and said,
"This man too was with him."
But he denied it, saying,
"Woman, I do not know him."
A short while later, someone else saw him and said,
"You too are one of them."
But Peter answered,
"My friend, I am not."
About an hour later, still another insisted,
"Assuredly, this man too was with him, for he is also a Galilean."
But Peter said,
"My friend, I don't know what you're talking about."
Just as he was saying this, the cock crowed, and the Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times." He went out and began to weep bitterly. The men who held Jesus in custody were ridiculing and beating him. They blindfolded him and questioned him, saying,
"Prophesy, who is it that struck you?"
And they reviled him in saying many other things against him. When the day came, the council of elders of the people met, both chief priests and scribes, and they brought him before their Sanhedrin. They said,
"If you are the Christ, tell us."
But he replied to them,
"If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question, you will not respond. But from this time on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God."
They all asked,
"Are you the Son of God?"
He replied to them,
"You say that I am."
Then they said,
"What further need do we have of testimony? We have heard it from his own mouth."
Then the whole assembly of them arose and brought him before Pilate. They brought charges against him, saying,
"We found this man misleading our people. He opposes the payment of taxes to Caesar and maintains that he is the Christ, the King."
Pilate asked him,
"Are you King of the Jews?"
He said to him in reply,
"You say so."
Pilate then addressed the chief priests and the crowds,
"I find this man not guilty."
But they were adamant and said,
"He is inciting the people with his teachings throughout all Judea from Galilee, where he began, even to here."
On hearing this, Pilate asked if the man was a Galilean. And upon learning that he was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was in Jerusalem at that time. Herod was very glad to see Jesus. He had been wanting to see him for a long time, for he had heard about him and had been hoping to see him perform some sign. He questioned him at length, but he gave him no answer. The chief priests and scribes, meanwhile, stood by accusing him harshly. Herod and his soldiers treated him contemptuously and mocked him. And after clothing him in resplendent garb, he sent him back to Pilate. Herod and Pilate became friends that very day, even though they had been enemies formerly. Pilate then summoned the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, and said to them,
"You brought this man to me and accused him of inciting the people to revolt. I have conducted my investigation in your presence and have not found this man guilty of the charges you have brought against him. Nor did Herod, for he sent him back to us. So no capital crime has been committed by him. Therefore, I shall have him flogged and then release him."
But all together they shouted out,
"Away with this man, release Barabbas to us."
Now Barabbas had been imprisoned for a rebellion that had taken place in the city and for murder. Again, Pilate addressed them, still wishing to release Jesus, but they continued their shouting,
"Crucify him, crucify him."
Pilate addressed them a third time,
"What evil has this man done? I find him guilty of no capital crime. Therefore, I shall have him flogged and then release him.
With loud shouts, however, they persisted in calling for his crucifixion, and their voices prevailed. The verdict of Pilate was that their demand should be granted. So he released the man who had been imprisoned for rebellion and murder, for whom they asked, and he handed Jesus over to them to deal with as they wished. As they led him away, they took hold of a certain Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country, and after laying the cross on him, they made him carry it behind Jesus. A large crowd of people followed Jesus, including many women who mourned and lamented him. Jesus turned to them and said,
"Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep instead for yourselves and for your children. For indeed, the days are coming when people will say, 'Blessed are the barren, the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' At that time, people will say to the mountains, 'Fall upon us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if these things are done when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?"
Now two others, both criminals, were led away with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him and the criminals there, one on his right, the other on his left. Then Jesus said,
"Father, forgive them. They know not what they do."
They divided his garments by casting lots. The people stood by and watched. The rulers, meanwhile, sneered at him and said,
"He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the chosen one, the Christ of God."
Even the soldiers jeered at him. As they approached to offer him wine, they called out,
"If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself."
Above him, there was an inscription that read, "This is the King of the Jews." Now, one of the criminals hanging there reviled Jesus, saying,
"Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us."
The other, however, rebuking him, said in reply,
"Have you no fear of God? For you are subject to the same condemnations. And indeed, we have been condemned justly, for the sentence we've received corresponds with our crimes. But this man has done nothing criminal."
Then he said,
"Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom."
He replied to him,
"Amen, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise."
It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, because of an eclipse of the sun. Then the veil of the temple was torn down the middle. Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Father, into your hands I commend my spirit."
And when he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion who witnessed what had happened glorified God and said,
"This man was innocent beyond doubt."
When all the people who had gathered for this spectacle saw what had happened, they returned home beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances stood at a distance, including the women who had followed him from Galilee and saw these events. Now there was a virtuous and righteous man named Joseph, who, though he was a member of the council, had not consented to their plan of action. He came from the Jewish town of Arimathea and was awaiting the kingdom of God. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. After he had taken the body down, he wrapped it in a linen cloth and laid him in a rock-hewn tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. It was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come from Galilee with him followed behind. And when they had seen the tomb and the way in which the body was laid in it, they returned and prepared spices and perfumed oils. Then they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
A special welcome to all of you who are watching us online today as we begin this Holy Week. Today you will be with me in paradise. Preserved only in Luke's gospel, these words are spoken as Jesus is being taunted by the crowd. Save yourself and us, they shout at Jesus, thought to be a savior. Even today we say, Jesus died to save us from our sins. We are saved by the blood of the Lamb. Jesus is my personal Lord and Savior. Savior is what Jesus is accused of by a crowd that feels betrayed by them. He promised to save us. From what? The Romans? Herod? Death? Save us from what? He cannot even save himself. The beloved Son of the loving God? Then why is he hanging on the cross? Tell me that, will you? Why doesn't Daddy save him now? Pilate is right. He is the king of nothing, naked with criminals. They only stole property. You, Jesus, are much worse. You hang accused of stealing souls. You hang accused of misleading people's hearts, of offering promises you could not keep, of offering power, now nailed useless, of proclaiming a loving God that doesn't exist, even for you. You were warned, well, now save yourself. In the midst of this tirade, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Have you ever been forgotten? On a date, a phone call, a birthday, a promotion, a devastating diagnosis. Isn't it horrible to be judged worth not remembering? Not worth the time, not worth the attention. Jesus is a king without attendance, a preacher with no converts, a teacher with no disciples, a lover with no friends. He hangs forgotten, except by the man hanging next to him. We have forgotten his name if we ever knew it. Tradition calls him Dismas, the good thief who stole heaven. All we really know is that while nailed, he reaches out to Jesus, one forgotten man to another. He asks to be remembered when Jesus reaches the peace of the kingdom of God. When you go home, think of me, remember me. Don't let me be forgotten, Dismas asked. Two men nailed to separate crosses reach out and hold on to each other. I promise you, this day, you will be with me in paradise. At last, Jesus has one believer. One heart has changed. There is someone to keep his promise for. There is someone to hand his promise to. There is someone for Jesus to die for. There is someone for Jesus to live for. It's so like Jesus to give his last gift to the person right next to him. God has not forgotten Jesus. God has sent him Dismas. And between the two of them, the kingdom of relationship is born. The kingdom of God begins. The kingdom of God is not about saving yourself. The kingdom of God is about saving others. The priest who passed by the battered body on the side of the road, hurrying off to temple, was saving himself. The rich man who left Lazarus ignored at his gate was all about saving himself. Those who leave others hungry, thirsty, naked, and alone are all about saving themselves. Jesus' kingdom is about others. His kingdom is about relationships. His kingdom is about the power to love even in the worst of times. His kingdom is about the power to forgive when we are persecuted, the power to give when we have nothing. His kingdom is about reaching out when nailed down. Sisters and brothers, this is the paradise we are promised. Shall we enter it with him or be forgotten?
Let us bring our needs and petitions to the Father.
Our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer. For the church, that we may commend our lives to God each day and be renewed in spirit by his faithful presence, let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For leaders of government and business, that they may work humbly and resolutely for peace and the protection of all human life, let us pray. For all who are suffering, particularly Christians being persecuted for their faith, that they may find their strength in the example of Christ, let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are experiencing loss in their lives, that God will sustain them, accompany them through their pain, and lead them into new life, let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have been condemned to death, that the Holy Spirit will help them turn to God and find hope and peace, let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Joseph Green, who we remember especially at this Mass, and for those who are seriously ill or hospitalized, including Chris Leach, Mary Calder, Monsignor Thomas Dewis, and for all who have recently died, let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for the needs of our sister parishes in Haiti and Baltimore, and the intentions written in our Book of Intercessions, and for what or for whom do we pray today?
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Rebecca Owens, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty and eternal God, as we recall and give thanks for the Paschal mystery, we ask you to hear and answer these prayers through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated.
The choir will sing a setting of hymn number 512. When you hear the hymn, please join us.
Thank you.
Pray, my sisters, my brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that though we do not merit it on our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere, to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Jesus Christ, for though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so, with all the angels and saints, we praise you forever.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed be Jesus, whom you sent to be the friend of children and of the poor. He came to show us how we can love you, Father, by loving one another. He came to take away sin, which keeps us from being friends, and hate, which makes us all unhappy. He promised to send the Holy Spirit to be with us always, so that we can live as your sons and daughters. God, our Father, we now ask you to send your Holy Spirit to change these gifts of bread and wine into the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. The night before he died, Jesus, your son, showed us how much you love us. When he was at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks and praise. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." When supper was ended, Jesus took the cup that was filled with wine. He thanked you, gave it to his friends, and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." Then he said to them, "Do this in memory of me." Our response is, we praise you, we bless you, we thank you. We praise you, we bless you, we thank you. And so, loving Father, we remember that Jesus died and rose again to save the world. He put himself into our hands to be the sacrifice we offer you. We praise you, we bless you, we thank you. Lord God, listen to our prayer. Send the Holy Spirit to all of us who share in this meal. May this Spirit bring us closer together in the family of the Church, with Francis our Pope, William our Bishop, all other bishops, and all who serve your people. We praise you, we bless you, we thank you. Remember, Father, our families and friends, and all those who do not love as we should. Remember those who have died. Bring them home to you to be with you forever. We praise you, we bless you, we thank you. Gather us all together into your kingdom. There we shall be happy forever with the Virgin Mary, Mother of God and our Mother. There all the friends of Jesus the Lord will sing a song of joy.
We praise you, we bless you, we thank you.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
With longing for the coming of God's kingdom, we pray as Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may always be free from sin and safe from all distress and anxiety, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith and courage of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Happy are we called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Please be seated. Our communion hymn is number 783, Unless a Grain of Wheat, number 783.
Unless a grain of wheat shall fall upon the ground and die, it remains but a single grain with no life. If we have died with him, then we shall live with him. If we hold firm, we shall reign with him. Unless a grain of wheat shall fall upon the ground, then it remains.
but a single grain with no love.
Many people terrors me, then they must follow me. Wherever I am, my servants will be. Unless a grain of wheat shall fall upon the ground and die, it remains but a single grain with no life. Make your home in me as I make mine in you. Those who remain in me bear much fruit. Unless a grain of wheat shall fall upon the ground and die, it remains but a single grain with no ground and die, it remains but a single grain with no life. Those who love me are loved by my Father. We shall be with them and dwell in shall fall upon the ground and die. It remains but a single grain with no life. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Peace which the world cannot give is my gift. Unless a grain of wheat shall fall upon the ground and die, it remains but a single grain with no
Here are today's announcements. The schedule for Holy Week can be found in the bulletin, on the parish website, and in Father Paul's flock notes. If you are a liturgical minister, please take a look at the Easter Mass schedule and sign up if you see a position that needs to be filled. This week's poor box contributions will benefit St. Gregory's Parish. If you're having a medical procedure or surgery soon, please meet our presider at the baptismal font for the sacrament of the anointing of the sick after he greets parishioners when Mass has ended. As we begin this most solemn week, we ask that you please leave the church in silence.
I do want to stress the need of liturgical ministers to please sign up for service. God willing, the For Easter Sunday, we will have an outdoor mass at 11:30. And so we need about a dozen or so people to help set it up. We have some tents to put up, and we have to put out furniture and other items used for mass. So if you can help out, and please let me know by way of email or call the parish office. And if you're Irish like me, put a Blessed Mother statue facing outside and pray that she will help us have beautiful weather like we did last Easter. Let us pray. Nourished by these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection, you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
May
Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Please maintain a spirit of awe and reverence as we begin Holy Week singing, Jesus, Remember Me, when you come into your kingdom.
Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
Thank you. Thank you.